appreciate, Pastor, for the opportunity to preach. If you have your Bibles tonight, John chapter 5. John chapter 5, beginning to read from verse 1. I have no intention of keeping you longer than 30 minutes because of the fact that we're breaking our fast. The book of John has in it 7 miracles listed. John writes with the idea in mind because he knows that people will face situations, they will face needs, they will face problems. But he writes because John understood that Jesus is the answer to all of man's problems. And in every action of Jesus, it's not only an act in time, but what that does is, it is a window into the reality of who God is tonight. Whatever Jesus did in the 7 miracles that John puts out in his book, they are not just an act of time or in time that Jesus perhaps managed to do, but it is a window for you and me tonight to show us the reality of who God is. I want to consider with you tonight a sermon I've entitled Healing at the Pool. Our God is a healer tonight. How many can say amen? Healing at the pool. The Bible reads verse 1. After this, there was a feast of the Jews, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Now there is in Jerusalem by the Sheep Gate a pool which is called in Hebrew Bethesda, having 5 porches. In these lay a great number of sick people, the blind, the lame, the paralyzed, waiting for the moving of the water. For an angel, verse 4, for an angel went down at a certain time into the pool and stirred up the water. Then whoever stepped in first after the stirring of the water was made well of whatever disease he had. Now a certain man was there who had an infirmity 38 years. When Jesus saw him lying there and knew that he had already been in that condition a long time, he said to him, "Do you want to be made well?" The sick man answered him, "Sir, I have no man to put me into the water, into the pool, rather, when the water is stirred up. But while I am coming, another steps down before me." Jesus said to him, "Rise, take up your bed and walk." Verse 9, and immediately the man was made well, took up his bed and walked. And that day was the Sabbath day. May God bless the reading of his word, healing at the pool. Let's consider number one, the long-term problems. Long-term problems. The reality of life tonight is that many problems are not for an hour. They are not for a week. It's not like you are held up in traffic and you're just waiting. You're saying, okay, this will be done in a few minutes and I'll be over. No, they are long-term. In our text, verse 5 says, a man was lying there who had been sick 38 years. This should be able to give us a perspective tonight. Imagine with me being in a condition for 38 years. I'm slightly above 38 years old on earth. I cannot imagine a person being in a condition for that long. No doubt this man had spent his money on doctors, the best doctors in the land. And again, if the condition was for an hour, if the condition was for a day, a week, we can deal with that. But we are told that this man was lying there for 38 years. The effect of this is that it begins to demoralize us. This is what long-term problems have. They have the ability to demoralize you. You can lose your faith in the fact that God is able to heal and that he's willing to heal. Listen to me tonight. I don't know about you, but I'm caring for my mother. My mother has been has been paralyzed for 4 years now. She's unable to speak. 3 years now, rather. Unable to speak, unable to move all by herself. I have seen the hand of God. I have seen God do a miracle. There's a progressive miracle upon her life. But the devil has afflicted her. She's paralyzed one side, unable to function. I can only imagine the torment that she's going through. If me, who is taking care of her, us who are taking care, are able to feel the pain, the fact that this was a person who was able to function on herself, move on herself, be able to speak and converse, but now for years I'm unable to hear the voice of my own mother, and I can only imagine the pain that she's going through, being in that situation. Listen to me tonight, this was not an easy place to be at. This man, the Bible says, he's paralyzed, he's unable to move by himself. He was in that condition for 38 long years. Listen, it has an effect. Long-term problems can cause you to lose your faith. You can become weary, you can become faint-hearted, you can begin to fail, or to begin to collapse, or to begin to unable to function, to begin to fail to move on. Again, human nature, and this is the worst thing, is that we begin to get used to the problem. We become accustomed mentally, emotionally, psychologically. We begin to own our situations. We make ourselves comfortable in our troubles. For 38 years, I can imagine going through the mind of this man. I can imagine as he sits beside the pool of Bethesda. I'm wondering, is he just going through the motions? Is he already defeated deep inside his heart? Because, I mean, if you notice the way he responded to our Lord Jesus, and I'll come to that, it's a defeated kind of mentality. And he's there, but he's not there. Maybe he's concluded, God made me like this. Things will never change. This is my portion. Verse 2 of our text. Now there is a Jerusalem by the sheep market, a pool which is called in the Hebrew Bethesda, having 5 porches in our text. This man was in this physical condition. But again, long-term conditions or long-term issues cut across all aspects of life. This can be a financial situation in your life. It can be a marriage situation in your life. It can be a ministry situation maybe in your life, and things have just been moving the way they've been moving. There has been no change. There has been no prospects of any improvement whatsoever. Again, for this man, it was a physical condition. But for you and I, it can be anything tonight. It can be a joblessness. And you're in that condition for years, pushed in application after application. It can be a marriage for years. There is nothing happening. You are just staying there for the sake of the children. Our text says, he's seated under a covered porch, making the waiting as comfortable as possible. I mean, the worst thing that can happen is for us to be comfortable in our situations. Comfortable as a loafer, comfortable as a jobless man, comfortable as a single guy. And you're saying there are no people to marry. Comfortable as a single woman, and you're saying there are no men to marry. This shelter provided a shade. The end result is people stop expecting a miracle. We conclude that the way things are, that's the way things will be. Listen to his words, verse 7. The impotent man answered him, "Sir, I have no man when the water is troubled to put me into the pool. But while I am coming, another steps down before me." This was his condition. And because he has no man, he is resigned. He said, Jesus, I mean God in flesh, comes to him face to face and asks him, do you want to get well? And his response is, in the face of God, I have no man. What he had known all of his life is that people will only get healed when they step into the pool after it has been stirred by the angel from God. That was the pattern that he was used to. That was the plan that he was exposed to. But God in the flesh danced with him face to face, and his answer was, I have no man. The abnormal had become normal for this man. This is just the way things are. And the truth of the word of God is that our confession becomes self-fulfilling. What we speak, sooner or later, will begin to manifest. Our confession becomes self-fulfilling. Numbers chapter 14, verse 28. These are the words of God. He says, so tell them, as surely as I live, declares the Lord, I will do to you the very things I heard you say. And so what are you saying tonight in your delay, in the delays of God, in the frustrations of God, in the misfortunes of life, in the pushbacks of life? What words are you speaking? Because God here says, he challenges his people. He says, as surely as I hear, well, as surely as I live, declares the Lord, I will do to you the very thing I heard you say. What are you speaking in your season of waiting? Many are simply going through the motions with no heart, no faith for a miracle. But the major lesson we see tonight is that as hopeless as the situation may be, as long-term as the condition may be, that case is able to be healed. It is able to change when God comes on the scene. No matter how long the circumstance has been, no matter how long the condition has been, our God is a miracle-working God tonight. You and I don't need to accept our current situation as being final. We need to step out by faith and begin to trust God that yes, even in this condition, yes, even in our condition, in our nation, things are able to change. My God is able to open a door for me. My God is able to bring a miracle in my life. We need to be able to step out by faith tonight. And we see in our text, verse 6, when Jesus saw him lying there and learned that he had been in that condition for a long time, he asked him, do you want to get well? Jesus knows us. He knows your condition. This is one of the only few miracles that Jesus initiated. As you study your Bible, you discover that many of the miracles, people approached Jesus. They cried out to Jesus, blind Bartimaeus. The Bible says he cried out to Jesus. He got the attention of Jesus. But in this one, Jesus, the Bible says, he steps into a territory of this man and begins to beg on him to say, listen, do you want to get well? Jesus stepped out and initiated the miracle. Shows us tonight, Jesus knows the condition of our heart. Let's look secondly tonight, the choices in faith. Faith is a choice of focus. Of the many benefits of a time of prayer and fasting, one of those is it's a time of focusing on God. And we see in our text here, when you focus on the problems, when you focus on the difficulties, the pain, the frustrations, the disappointments of life thus far, when you focus on that, you'll be unable to see Jesus in your circumstances tonight. Because Jesus is right there standing in front of this man and tells him, do you want to get well? Yet the man, his focus was misplaced. He begins to give an excuse, I have no one. Again, God in flesh stands in front of this man. He's offering a miracle to this man. He cannot see the answer for the problem. You and I tonight must deliberately choose to look to God. You have to factor God in your equation. Put God into your situation. Imagine what would happen if God was to step in your situation. Imagine the miracle that would transpire if only you allowed God to step into your situation. Listen to the prophet Isaiah. He says these words in Isaiah 6 verse 1. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting upon a throne high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple. It's a choice of faith. Tonight is a choice of focus, where you choose to place your faith, where you choose to place your reliance. Pastor mentioned he in his offering, he said many place their trust in their bank account, they place their trust in so and so. But you and I tonight, just like Isaiah said, in the year that the king died, I saw that it's a deliberate attempt. You have to focus your eyes on Jesus tonight. Keep your eyes on Jesus. Romans chapter 4 tells us the story of Abraham. Romans 4 verse 18 says, against all hope, Abraham in hope believed, and so became the father of many nations. Just as it had been said to him, so shall your offspring be. Without weakening in his faith, he faced the fact that his body was as good as dead, since he was about 100 years old. And that Sarah's womb was also dead, yet he did not waver through unbelief regarding the promise of God, but was strengthened in his faith and gave glory to God. Verse 21, being fully persuaded that God had power to do what he had promised. And so here is Abraham tonight. He wants to see a miracle, but time has passed. The promise of God was loud and clear. The promise of God was there for him to see. And yet, the Bible says that time is passing. There's delay to the fulfillment of the promise. But we are told that Abraham, even though his own body was against the biology and all that, the Bible says he did not waver nor stagger at the promises of God. He laid hold of the words of God. What are you standing on tonight as a man, as a woman, in your situation? What word in this book are you laying your faith upon? What scripture are you standing on? As the Bible says, Abraham, even though his body and that of his wife had passed the years of childbearing, the Bible says he remained hopeful. He remained committed to the word that God had spoken to him, and that God, the one who spoke those words, he is a faithful God, and he will keep what he has promised. You and I must fix our eyes on Jesus. Must fix our eyes on Jesus. This calls for a change, because this man was used to the sympathy of the people. Whoever passed and went into the temple, they saw this man. I mean, 38 years is a long time. Can you imagine coming to church, and every day that you come to church, you find this man by the sheep gate, and the Bible says they would bypass him. I can imagine the sympathy that people had on him. Those who were moved would throw some money to him. Those again who were moved, they would begin. But for this man to reach this position, for this man to be able to want to a miracle in his life, he was going to let loose of all those sympathies from men and women. The alms that he was getting, the free food that he was getting, will have to stop. If God moves on his behalf, all that will have to end. We must allow God to move in the manner that he wants to move tonight. Because this man in our text, he was used, the Bible says, God had provided in his divine wisdom an opportunity that an angel would descend from heaven. The angel would stir the water in the pool, and at the moment a person would step in, no matter the condition they had, no matter the sickness, no matter the problem, the Bible says that person would be healed. That was the known way of healing for this man. That was the traditional way of healing for these people. That was what they expected, that if I am to be healed, I will have to wait until the angel descend, the angel stirs the water, and I be the first one to step in. That's the only time I can be healed. But guess what? Tonight, you and I must allow God to move in the manner that He wants to move, and not the traditional way, and not the way that we are used to, and not the way that we are accustomed to. But we must allow God to move in the manner that He wants to. In verse 4, the Bible says, "For an angel went down at a certain season into the pool and troubled the water. Whoever then first, after the troubling of the water, stepped in, was made whole of whatever disease he had." This was a tradition and a practice. This was what was expected, that the angel would come and stir the water. It would be fixed this way. I will be healed only in this way. This is the mentality of this man, that I can only get well if the angel comes and I step in. And no fault of his own tonight, because that was a tradition. That was what he was exposed to. But are you willing tonight to challenge what you're exposed to and subject it to what God is saying? Can you subject what you have known all of your life to the Word of God? You and I need to be able to do that. We need to allow God to be able to do what God only can do. Verse 8 of our text. Then Jesus said to him, "Get up, pick up your mat and walk." Jesus disturbs this man's theology. He messes with his mind. This man, all he has known in all the 38 years of his existence, or at least of his disease, is that the only way remedy can come to me is if I step into the water after the angel stirred the water. And yet Jesus comes on the scene and he says, "No longer like that." What is Jesus saying to you tonight? You have a conditioned way of how the blessing will come. Some of us, when we pray, we have a rich uncle somewhere. "God bless me financially." And so we are thinking of your rich uncle somewhere. That uncle will wire you something. That's a traditional way. That's the way you have known. Jesus steps up to this man. He doesn't even tell him, okay, let me stir the water, then you get in and you get well. No. He says, "Get up and walk." God many times moves completely different than we may think. The question is, will you trust Him? Will you trust Him? Let me close. Look at one final thought tonight. After the miracle. After the miracle. There's a mistaken idea of life many times, and that is to think that we do not have to take personal responsibility. That it's all up to God. Fate, destiny, things happen only because God chooses. His plans, whatever God wants to happen in my life, they will happen whether I play a part or not. It's destiny. No, that's a mistaken idea tonight. You and I have to take personal responsibility. But we go as far as saying if someone else is blessed financially or otherwise, it's because God has chosen them to be blessed. He likes them better. They have a better situation. They are favored of God. Others, it's a blame mentality. If anything goes wrong, it's not my fault. Again, this is an age-old syndrome. It started way back in creation. Genesis chapter 3, verse 12 and 13, the Bible says, the man said, "The woman you put me here with, if I was alone, I was going to be very well, oh God. I was going to do very good. But you put me with this woman. It's her fault. She gave me the fruit of the tree and I ate. Verse 13. Then the Lord God said to the woman, what is this you have done? And the woman said, the serpent, oh God, you created, made me. Imagine, the only creature that took responsibility was the snake. That's an old age syndrome. But our scripture tonight shows us the details of after the miracle. The whole text, I didn't read that part, I'll read it in a moment. And that is that we have a part to play. Hear me and hear me well tonight. If you're saved here and you want to stay saved, there is a part you have to play. Oh, we will pray for you. We will fast for you. We'll remember you into God in prayer. But that's as far as we can go. You have a part to play. In ministry, if you want to do well, if you want God to use you, you have a part to play. You cannot just say, if God has anointed me, He will do it. No, you can't do that. If God has chosen me to be this, then I will be no matter what happens. No, it doesn't happen like that. It's not like tossing the coin and say, heads or tails, since it's heads, it has been destined. No, you have a part to play. I'm speaking from experience tonight. I remember vividly the day I made a decision that I'm sick and tired of just coming to church and playing church and just going through the motion. I'm not sensing God. I'm not one that functions by feelings, but I'm on some feelings to help. I'm not seeing God in my life. I come to church. People see me to be faithful. They see me to be, I'm in ministry. I'm playing the keyboard and all that. But when I go back home, I'm not sensing, I'm not going any further. I'm not going anywhere. My spiritual life was stagnant, and until I became sick and tired, and I said, God, unless you move, I'm ready to stop all this. I do not want just to be playing church, just to be showing up. I want you to do a work in my life. And from that moment, I began to put in the work, and God, I'm telling you, God reignited the fire, the passion, the zeal for the things of God. And listen to me, there's a part you have to play, and it is called taking responsibility. Many have prayed a prayer, many have bowed their knee at this altar, they have gotten saved, miraculously saved. We cannot question their conversion, but listen to me, it is the next step that carries more weight. It is the next step. Will they walk the talk? Will they walk the prayer? Will they keep themselves holier? And that calls for taking personal responsibility tonight. Cannot leave it all up to God. Qui sera, sera. No, you cannot leave it all up to God. Personal responsibility. Many pray a prayer, but they never get to enjoy a life free from sin, because they do not take personal responsibility. Jesus, he meets this man in the temple, the Bible says he meets him. And as he meets him, he wants this man to have a new mindset. And that mindset is a mindset of taking personal responsibility. It does not come naturally. Verse 14 of our text, the Bible says, later Jesus found him at the temple and said to him, see, you are well again. Stop sinning or something worse may happen to you. These are the words of Jesus. No, it's not wise. You get saved and you continue sinning. Jesus confronts this man. You have something has taken place inside of you. A miracle has transpired. 38 years you were bound in this sickness. I have healed you. But Jesus meets him. He says, listen, you must stop sinning. How many love Jesus tonight? I mean, he's straight to the point. Stop sinning. Meaning you have something to do with your problems. You can do something. After healing, things will not just fall into place. He says you have a part to play. Stop sinning. Stop depending on handouts. Stop. Do something with your life. Be productive. How does this play out in our lives? Depending on where you are at tonight. If you're in school, aim high, study hard. If you're working, be the best there's ever been, no matter the job. If you mop floors, be the best floor mopper there's ever been. If your job is to sweep, be the best sweeper there's ever been. Why? Because you are a child of God now. You had the job. Find another one if you can. In doing business, be the best to the best of your ability. In managing your finances, I mean, many. It's not that God is not making money come your way. Many, it's the money has come my way, but God, where has it gone? Where has it gone? I mean, there was 15 bin, but where has it gone? It's called budgeting. It will tell you where the money is supposed to go. And if something outside the budget comes up, you tell that something and say, let me consult my budget. And if it's not in the budget for that month, I mean, you will not die. If you don't buy a new pair of sneakers in that month, you will not die. Tell it that, listen, we can consider you next month. People come to me, used to come to me many times, say, Pastor, I died, I do that. No, listen. Yes, thank God you have tithe, but also God is concerned of how you use the 90% that remains. He's concerned. You can't just say, I've removed the tithe, and so however I use it, God will bless. No, God doesn't bless reckless spending. In marriage, you have to factor in forgiveness. Words were spoken. In anger, words were spoken in frustration. But you, as a man, as a woman, you have to factor in forgiveness tonight. A new mindset. Jesus challenged this man. As you go, as you live your life, make sure that you do not sin. Our decisions will be the determining factor in our lives. If you want a different future, you have to make different decisions. And Jesus challenges this man not to sin anymore. From now onwards, your decision, the decisions you make, go and sin no more. Is it possible? Yes, the Holy Ghost is our ally in this. You and I are not supposed to function in non-sin. And then we come and say, no, I'll repent. Jesus challenges that mentality, says, go from now on and sin no more. So this man had to rearrange his life. He had to rearrange his life. Jesus wants to step in tonight and bring a miracle in our lives. Every head is bowed tonight, every eye is closed. In respect to God and the person that is seated next to you tonight, I thank God for you. I appreciate you tonight. You're here, you're not saved, you're not right with God. You're not born again. Tonight, Jesus wants to heal you. He wants to reach down and save you and deliver you, set you free from every affliction, every bondage. Jesus wants to heal. That's you tonight. You're not saved, you're not born again, but you're here. Thank God for it. Would you lift up your hand to where I'll be able to see it? I want to surrender to Jesus tonight. Thank God. Thank God. Thank God. Speaking to Christians tonight, there are those that are watching us online. You're not saved, you're not born again. I want you to pray this prayer if you want to surrender your heart to Jesus. Repeat after me, say, Lord Jesus, tonight I come as a sinner. I'm asking you to come into my heart. Be my Lord and my Savior. The blood of Jesus sets me free. I believe you died on the cross for my sins. Tonight, save me, wash me in your blood. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. I want to change the order of the service tonight. Speaking to Christians, tonight I want to open these altars for